Hi, today we're going to be having a look at this AVerMedia Live Gamer Portable 2 Plus. Now, we purchased this off eBay for spares or repair and was advertised as having no power. I think I paid £24.50 for it. I'll just bring the listing up so you can have a look. And I think on Amazon they retail for around about £150. So let's get it out of the box. It's got a bit of bubble wrap on it. It looks in very nice condition, looks pretty much brand new this. I can't see any scratches or anything on it. Okay, what else have we got in here? Is there anything else? We've got a USB power lead. Looks like an audio cable and an HDMI cable. Right. I'll just go and grab my USB tester and resume. Right, so let's plug this in. Oh, it's drawing a little bit of current. But it doesn't seem to be doing anything else. It's like we haven't got any light on the front here. Interesting how it's drawn some current though. Now, just to rule it out, I'll see if I can find another USB lead and we'll try another USB lead just in case it's the lead that's faulty. Right, just back with another lead. Let's try this one. Well, it's just doing the same. So it's not the lead. Right, let's see if we can figure out how to get into this. Well, I can't see any screws. So it's either clipped together or there might be some hidden screws underneath this base plate here. So let's zoom down a bit and I'll just find a spudging tool. I just spotted a screw or something there. Here we go. Screw out. Let's see if that gets her anywhere then. Yes. Right then. Looks like we've got a little backup battery up here. Let's see if we can get this little board out as well. Right, now I may need to bring the microscope in on this one so we can just get a bit of a closer look, so I'll just go set that up. Right, so let's have a look over this board then. So we've got a couple of voltage regulators there. And I'm not sure what that IC is, it could be a something like a 74245 logic chip perhaps. There's the audio connectors at the bottom there. And that could possibly be some kind of serial debug port. That's kind of what it looks like. I'm not sure there is a DRV604. I'll see if I can look that up. And that looks like another buffer chip there, I think it is. Another 245. There's the micro SD card slot. And it looks like we've got a few power supplies in the middle of the board here. There's a few inductors there. So those will be for providing different voltages. Let's just check this micro USB connector. Oh, it appears to be soldered correctly. There doesn't appear to be any dry joints or anything on that. Let's just check the pins on that, just in case. You never know. All the pins appear to be there. We've got a little power supply just there. And there are the volume up and down buttons with another little power supply in the middle of those. What's this IC? It is an IT6663FN. So I'm not sure what that is, so we'll look that up. See if we can find a data sheet for that. There's another little power supply just to the left of it here. Just here. There's the HDMI connectors. One there and one just next to it. And those appear to be soldered correctly as well. I think this switch here is the selection switch that selects between USB or standalone operation. Right, let's flip the board over and we'll have a look at the other side. And we've got an IC here, which looks like it goes to the audio jacks here, so I guess that's some kind of analog to digital converter perhaps, or audio codec. That's what I think that'll be. I'm not sure on this IC here. I'm not sure on that IC there either. I've got a flash chip here. And this looks like the main processor. And it's got a little power supply just above it here. A little bit of a crooked capacitor. And we've got a couple of oscillators here. Looks like a 27 megahertz and possibly a, let's see, that 3.2 or 32, I would think. Okay, we've got another little power supply, a voltage regulator here, and another crystal, probably 28 megahertz. And an analog device, as I see there, ADV7840. I'm not too sure what that one is. It could be some kind of video capture device or something by the look of it. By the look of the tracers going to the HDMI ports, I would think. Not over that direction. Looks like we've got a fuse here marked F1. So we'll check that. And another one marked F2 just along here. Again, another little power supply. And I think that's pretty much it. I can't really see a lot else on this board. So I think we'll check those fuses first. So I'll just get the test meter. And we'll check this one first. And that one seems intact. And let's try this one. And that one seems intact too. So it doesn't appear to be the fuses. So I think the next thing we'll do is we'll power it up and we'll check to see if we get voltages on some of these power supplies. Then we'll also get the oscilloscope out and we'll see if we get any clock signals on these oscillators here or crystals. Right, so I've got the board powered up now. Let's just see what we've got on these capacitors here. So we've got 5 volts coming in on that one. And we've got 1.8 on that one. So I guess that power supply is working okay. Let's see, we've got a couple of little inductors here. Let's see what we've got on that one. 1.1 volts. And 0.3 on that, that seems a little bit low. Let's just try here. 1.8 and 5 volts in, so I guess that one's okay as well. Five volts. We've got 0.9 on that one. And a little power supply down the bottom here. Let's just see what we're on that. 1.1. So we've got 5 volts going into it and 1.1 coming out of it. Now let's just flip the board over and we'll just have a look on the other side. So we've got 5 volts there. And 1.5 coming out of this one. Now there's another power supply over in this corner here, next to where those fuses are. Let's see if we can get there and focus a bit better. So 3.3 volts. And 5.3 going into it, which must come in on this fuse here. Well, we don't seem to have any voltage on this fuse here. On this one, we've got 5 volts. But on this one, we haven't got any voltage. So that's a bit strange. Let's see if we can see where those, where this fuse goes to. So it goes along here to a pad. And then along there to a pad. I'll see if I can flip this board over. I'll just unplug it a second. So those pads are on the other side of here. I can't see any components around here. I can't see any traces where those pads go to. I'm just wondering if it's got something to do with the HDMI sockets. So the fuse is just there. So it's around about here somewhere where those pads go to. But it could be a multi-layer board, so I'm not too sure whereabouts they go to, so maybe a bit hard to trace them. But But we've got voltages on all of these power supplies. But whether or not they're correct voltages or not, I'm not sure, because we haven't got a schematic for this. So perhaps we've got a 1.1 volt and we should have 3 volts. I think I'll hook the scope up and we'll have a look to see if we get any oscillations on any of these crystals here. Right, so I'll go and hook the scope up. Right, I've got the scope hooked up. So let's probe on this one here. Right, we've got a waveform on that one, and it's, so that should be 32768 kilohertz. So that's probably a timekeeping crystal for something like a real time clock. That's what that value is normally used for, something like that. So that one's working, it's oscillating correctly. Let's try this one. I'm not on the right scale here, but if we look at the bottom of the scope there, it's showing 27 megahertz. So that one's oscillating correctly. Right, where's the other ones? There's another one over here. So 24. Let's just try this capacitor here. There we go. So what's that one supposed to be? 24 megahertz. I'm seeing 24.5 there, but that could just be my trigger level just being a little bit off there. Well, that one's oscillating as well. Now, I believe I did see another crystal somewhere. There's a black one somewhere. It was over here. Nice. Let's try this one. I've got about 28 megahertz on that one, and it is. So all of the oscillators are oscillating and we've got voltages everywhere. So why isn't this working? You see, I can't see anything blowing. Unless one of the main ICs has failed. I mean, I suppose it could be a dry joint on one of the balls on one of these, perhaps. It could even be a firmware problem. I've had a couple of those lately as well. Right, I think I'm going to have to do a little bit more research to see if I can find out if anybody else has had a problem like this. So I just thought I'd try plugging the HDMI lead in from my microscope into this and taking the output from it back to the TV just to see if there's any power on that fuse there. So if we go from here to here now and just measure on that fuse where it didn't have power before, we've got 5 volts. And if I unplug the lead from the microscope, we haven't got any voltage now. So that fuse is definitely from the HDMI, so it must be like an HDMI detection fuse or something. So, but unfortunately, it's still not switching on. If I just plug that in there, press the button, I've still got nothing. And if I try the mode switch or whatever on the front here, so we still have nothing. I'm going to try tracing some of the signals on these ICs now I've got the data sheets for them. Right, so on this IC, which is an audio codec with a stereo amplifier, pin 8 and 9 are serial clock and serial data. So let's see if we're getting any data on those. Well, on the scope, we've just got 3.3 volts there, so what I'll do, I'll power it off and then power it back on. And there's nothing happening there. We haven't got any clock there. So it's not even trying to initialize that chip. This chip here is a programmable clock generator. So what that does, it takes a clock in, I think, on pin 1 and divides it or whatever and sends it out depending on what it's programmed to on pin 14 and pin 12 and 3, sorry, 12 and pin 12 and 13 here are the pins that it takes serial clock and data on. So let's have a poke on those, and again I'll try. Powering it off and back on. And we didn't get anything on that pin. Let's try this one. Right, so we're not getting any clock and data sent to this chip either. Right, let's have a poke about on this flash chip. So I know there's data should be on pins 29, 30, 31 and 32, which are about here. So let's just put the scope probe on there, and we've got nothing at the moment. Let's just try switching it off and back on. Alright, so we did get a burst of data there, and now nothing. Let's just try the next pin up, we'll just switch it off and on again. And again, we did get a brief blast of data there. Let's try that again. And the next pin up. So it looks like it's trying to load. Looks like it's trying to load its firmware. And then either the chip is trying to initialize another IC and it's failing to do so, causing it to crash, or I wonder if it's got some kind of firmware problem on this. I wonder if the firmware is getting corrupt somehow. So that's what I think so far. It's either initialization error, so perhaps one of these ICs has failed and it's trying to initialize it and it can't, which is then causing it to crash, or corrupt firmware possibly. I'm just going to have a look on the internet just to see if anybody else has had a similar problem with this or with these devices, just to see if there's a firmware update procedure or recovery, just to see if that's a possibility or not. So I found this post on Reddit where it said format the card FAT32 or XFAT and then hold down the volume plus and volume minus buttons until the LED goes off, but the LED is not lit on this one. And it says that avalog.bin will be saved at the root directory. Well, I tried that and nothing happened. When you plug the device into the PC, it doesn't actually enumerate with anything. You won't get anything in the device manager. However, what I've noticed is if I unplug it, if I hold this button down and plug it in, it gets detected as a composite device. And if I go to properties, and we'll get the details up, we'll go to hardware IDs, we'll get this hardware ID. And if I search for that, we'll get something called an iCatchTech SPA6350, which I believe is this chip here. And it's used in sort of action cameras and things like that. So I don't know if there's a way I can recover the software. I've been onto the AVerMedia site and it suggests putting some files onto the SD card. And there's a program that I've downloaded. So I'm going to try that next and see if that'll maybe reflash it or something like that. So that's my next job. Right, so this is the program here. And it says the device is not detected, so So that's not detecting it. I wonder if I put the update files onto the SD card, if that'll have any effect. Let's try that. Right, so I've just copied the two files to the SD card here. Let's see if anything happens when I plug it in now. Let's try holding this button down again. So it doesn't look like that's doing anything either. Right, I'm not sure what to do next then. Nice. I'll have to do a little bit more work, see if I can figure out what to do next. Well, I still haven't gotten very far with this. So what I thought I'd do, I'd order a programming adapter for a TSOP 48, which is what this chip is here. And this chip holds the firmware. So I'm going to remove this chip. I'm going to use some low melt solder, I think, first, and then heat it up with the rework station. And the reason is, directly behind the chip, we've got this SD card reader, which is plastic as well. And I'm concerned that we may melt it. So I thought if I use some low melt solder, use the soldering iron, apply it on the pins here first, and then we'll heat it up, it should be easier to remove. So I'll bring the microscope in and then we'll do that. Right, so I'm going to apply some flux to these pins first. And then we'll get some low melt solder on them. And what that'll do, it'll lower the melting temperature, so we'll not need as much heat with the rework station. In fact, I might be able to just remove it with that, with the iron. I'll just try that. That's one side of the chip lifted up. That's the old chip off. We didn't even need to use the rework station. Right, I'm just going to put some flux on these pins. Then we're just going to use some solder wick and the iron just to remove that, the old solder. Right, I'm just going to clean that up now with some IPA and a cotton bud. Right, so I've put the chip in the TSOP 48 holder, so we'll plug it into the program and we'll try and read it. Right, I've got the chip in the programmer now. So the first thing we need to do is select the correct IC, which is this 23NO1HVSI. So I'll select that, and then hopefully we should be able to read this chip. So we'll hit read, and we'll just let it do its thing for a couple of minutes or whatever. Well, halfway. It'll be interesting to see what this chip contains, to see if it has got any firmware in it still, or whether the firmware's been corrupted. Because I can't find any electrical problems with this, I think it's something to do with the firmware. Right, so this is the data here that we've read into the buffer. I can see it says there NAND RSV, so it does contain some data. Let's just have a little bit look further down. I can see some data there. Whether it's correct or not's another thing. I've got a whole load of zeros there. And now we've just got FF, so there's a little bit of data there. Not a lot. Possibly some kind of table. A little bit more data. But now, unless there's some data further on, it just seems like the rest of the chip's blank. I'll just scroll down a bit more there. So yeah, so that's the reason why it's not working. The chip's pretty much blank, apart from a little bit of data at the beginning. So I wonder if the user was trying to do a firmware upgrade and it failed somehow and blanked the chip. That's pretty much what it looks like. I say it's only got a little bit of data at the beginning, and then pretty much the rest of the chip is blank. Right, I'll have to see if I can figure out if I can program this chip with one of the firmware files that I downloaded. So I've loaded one of the firmware files that I downloaded from the AVerMedia site into a hex editor, just so I can have a quick look to see what the chip's supposed to contain. And you can see straight away there's a lot more data in this file. I mean, there's even bits of text in there, you can see there. If we scroll further down, you can see there's more data. There was a little bit of FFs there, like a block of them, but not a lot. A little block of some more, and then we've got more data. I'll keep going down. There's more text. So, definitely a firmware issue. Now I've got to try and figure out whether it's possible to program this firmware file into that chip somehow, because it's in a slightly different format. This is something called a SunP burn file, which is expecting to read off an SD card, but because the unit isn't booting up and initializing the SD card, it can't read this file. So I'm not sure whether we're going to be able to do this or not. So I remembered about this header. I thought I'd have a quick mess about with that. So what I've done is I've connected a serial to USB UART here to this header connector. And I thought I'd fire up a program that I've used before called Putty. So I'll just pull it up on the screen there so you can see what's going on. And if we unplug this and then plug it back in, we'll get some info there where it's trying to boot from NAND 0 and fails because obviously the NAND chip's not there. And then it says enter an SP boot. So if I unplug this, hold that button down and plug it in, we'll get something different. It comes up entering SP boot mask ISP USB 2.0. Then it comes up with a couple of other things, and then something about USB vendor reset, it looks like. I just thought that was interesting. I've tried typing some commands back to it, like help or whatever, but I haven't had any responses yet, so I'm not sure whether that's going to be any use or not, but I just thought it was something a little bit interesting. So we know the firmware is non-existent on this chip, so I thought, well, I'll refit the chip. We'll try connecting up the serial converter again, and then we'll see what we get on the console, see if anything changes. And now when I press, I'm getting a prompt. And I can type help, and I've got a few commands there I can do. There's load firmware, which if we try that, I'm not really sure how you use it. It says, you know, sort of, I think that's for loading it into memory. We've got USB LD, which I guess is USB load. But then it came up with an error and didn't work properly. But I think that puts it into that bootloader mode that you have when you hold the button down. So anyway, I tried following the procedure on the AVerMedia site for updating the firmware. That didn't work, because obviously there's no firmware there actually on the IC to tell it to load from the SD card, which is how you normally update these. So I started looking at the actual chip here, this system on chip. There was a couple of other forums, a couple of other posts on Reddit that I found that what to do with updating the firmware, but was pretty much updating from the SD card. And the same on this one. So then I started looking at the actual system on chip, this V35 iCatch chip. And I found a data sheet for it explaining a little bit about the chip. But then I found out that this same chip is actually in some action cams called the Ekin H9. And I noticed that they're quite prone to breaking themselves, which is pretty much what this has done. And then somebody posted that they found the tools FRM for loading firmware. And he was able to pull some files, bin, config, JPEGs using FRM and modify the camera's name, version, etc. So I thought, oh, that sounds interesting. So I had a look around and I found this folder called Firmware Fix, which is for them Econ cameras, or Econ, however you pronounce it. So I downloaded that and I tried running it to see what would happen. And it says USB device not connected. I say okay. And then the program loads up here. Now, what I found out was you had to download some drivers for it, but the drivers are only 32 bits, and I'm running a 64-bit operating system, so I can't use the drivers. But I have got another laptop which has got Windows 7 on, so we'll try the program on there and see if we get anywhere. Right, so I've just tried installing the driver, which seems to install okay. So let's try running this FRM program and see what happens. Right, USB device not connected. There you are. If I go into the other mode now by holding the button down, so this is like the bootloader mode. Just see if anything came up on putty. Right, so it's in the USB bootloader mode now. I'll just try running this FRM program. Well, it didn't complain it's not connected. The only problem I've got is I haven't got the firmware for this. Well, I have, but it's not in the right format. Well, it says USB device connected, so that's some progress. NAND header error. Please try program all. Right, well, we seem to have some errors there now. I'll try firmware only. I'm not too sure what's going on there then. Well, I've just tried selecting the RSV only and it seems to be doing something. I don't know whether it's actually doing anything constructive or not, or whether it's just sort of hung. It just says writing adf.bin and it just seems to have stopped there. Right, so I've got it writing firmware and it seems to have finished. But obviously this is not the right firmware for the device, because this is for a Econ camera. So let's see what happens if we reboot it now, see if it does anything. Checksum failed. Well, at least it seems to be writing firmware or something to it. Let's try that again. Let's see, it's complete. That checksum failed. Right. What now then? So my son has one of these, but it's the different model of this one. It's the 510 and this is the 513. So I hooked his up to the USB lead here and I went into this mode of the program, the advanced mode. And what you can do, if you right click on things, you can get or get image. So what I did was I got the files from his one and saved them. So I'm going to try programming to this one now, but I don't think it'll work because his is the 510 and this is the 513. But we'll give it a go, we'll see what happens. Let's try program all. Well, it says not responding at the moment. More spaces needed. Right, okay. Let's see what that does then. It seems to be doing something. Let's see, it's finished. Let's try rebooting it and see if anything happens. Oh, I've got some blue lights flashing. And it's showing lots of stuff on the screen here. But I wonder if we'll get any display on it. Like I say, I think it might have different chips in this, so we can try it, but at least it's doing a lot more than what it did. So I think we're on the right path. Right, so I've connected it up to the microscope as an input and the TV. And I've also put the software on the PC here. It actually seems to be working. And if I wave my fingers in front of the microscope there, you can see it. Now the only thing is, it's coming up as a Live Gamer Portable 2, and this is supposed to be a 2 Plus. I think that's obviously because we've got different firmware on than what it should have. So I might have a look, now I've got a rough understanding of how it works, and I know I can program it now. I might have a look at the other firmware that we downloaded to see if I can pull it apart and get it working properly. Now, if I just restart this. We've got a lot more commands now as well. We've got loads of commands here now on putty that we can mess about with. So I think that might be a bit interesting as well. Right, I'm going to have a look at the firmware file that I downloaded from AVerMedia and see if we can pull that apart, get it into the other program and then program this properly so it shows up as the correct device. So looking at the binary file, I started having a bit look through it and I found a couple of things where it said FAT12. Which is a file system, so I thought, well, I'll see if I can extract those. So what I did was I tried 7-zip on one of the files. If we go to open archive, it lets me extract some of the files here. And one of them contains the USB string for the products with the IDs. So what I did after that, I removed the front part of the file and it found some more. So some of these go in the A drive because it seems like the file system on this thing has got two floppy drives or floppy drives, as I've seen it in the comments in the code. So we've got these two floppy drives, one of them holds the user files and one of them holds some other settings. So if we go into the user res here, we've got this file here which holds the device serial number. And if I just ultra edit that, it's just set to all zeros and then 513 currently. So what I'll do, I'll change it to the actual device's serial number. And there was two other parts that I had to find. So I looked at the code that I extracted from my son's capture card and found out where the main firmware lives. And that's it there. So I managed to extract that and save that as a file. And then I think there was another one called DRAM parameters, which actually starts with DRAM PAR 1. So that was easy to find in the firmware file. So I just copied and pasted that into a new file as well. So now I've got all the files. Let's try flashing them and see what happens. So what I did was I copied the number off the bottom here. So we've got the correct serial number and programmed it into here. So let's see if we can get this thing working properly now. I'll just fire up this FRM program again. I'll go to advanced, burn all, exists. Do you want to cover it? I presume that means do you want to overwrite it? Well, that looks better. All finished. Right, let's see if that's made any difference then. See where it shows up in device. Oh, what's this? Install a new device driver software. Well, that's interesting. So if we go to Imaging Devices, yes, Live Game Portable 2 Plus. Let's try the properties on that, see if it says 513 on the end now. Details, hardware IDs, 513. Right, let's see if it actually records anything then. Right, let's try this now then. Well, this has been an unusual fix, if nothing else. There we go. AVerMedia Record Central's popping up. Looks like it's reading the device serial number there. It looks like it's in the console that I've got hooked up. Yeah. And there we go. It's showing Live Game at Portable 2 Plus now. And we've got a picture. Excellent. Right then, I think it's just a matter of putting it in its case now, and I think that's it, all fixed. Right, so I think we'll unplug all of this now. Let's check the buttons are all in line. Right, let's just give it one last test then. Right, well, it's all lit up nice. Well, that must be the record button. Yeah, so it's actually recording now. Yeah, so great. Right, excellent. I didn't think we'd be to save this one, but we managed, so that's another good fix. Right then, if you enjoyed this video, please give it the thumbs up. If you want to see more like it, please subscribe. Any comments or questions, please leave it in the comments section below. And as always, have a great day. Thanks for watching.